You got 20 minutes, man.
Yeah.
I think we got about another minute. What kind of question is that?
Thank you very much. What about?
Hello.
How are you? Are you okay?
Good, man. How are you doing?
Yeah, very well. Thank you. Cheers.
I'm held some. Well, can you? Yeah, is it okay there? Right. Alright.
Is that okay for sitting
down? Yeah, sit down, man.
Alright, thank you.
Look at you, man.
I know, I've come prepared, yeah.
What is this, internet or TV show?
Internet, I've read your books as well a couple of times, getting notes off it and everything this, so yeah.
How much time do you have?
We only got 20 minutes, unfortunately, okay.
Okay. I didn't know we were on at 8:40, so it's like, fuck.
All right, so first question, Chris. How did you become part of Rich Ward's Fozzy Osbourne?
Shit, man. I mean, we just met up at an arena one day and kind of became fast friends, kind of were kindred spirits. And I told him I'd been playing in bands since I was 12 years old. And he said, oh, cool. Well, I got a cover band. You should play with us sometime. And I had about 4 months off, so I gave him a call. And we played two shows as Fozzy Osbourne. And then after that, there was like a bidding war because of who was in the band, Chris from the WWE and Rich from Stuck Mojo. And that's kind of how it all started.
Two shows, that's impressive.
Yeah, two shows. Yeah. And there was a bidding war for sight unseen. Excuse me, and sound unheard, so that's pretty cool.
Yeah, really good, yeah. I've been in a band for 4 years, and...
Yeah, no kidding. But like I said, it wasn't just that I didn't just wake up one day and go, hey, I want to be a rock and roll singer. Like, I've been playing since I was 12, and I did, you know, played in the bars and played in the high school battle of the bands, and did the, you know, the parties and, you know, all that stuff. So it was a long time coming, but I've been, even when I started wrestling at 19, I still continued to play and record and do music. So it was something that I'd been wanting to do and just waiting for the right opportunity at the right time.
Okay, let's have a look. Is it okay if we concentrate a little bit on the wrestling side of things as well?
Whatever you want, you got 20 minutes, man.
Yeah, okay. Right, okay, so having worked in so many different territories and countries over the years before joining the WWF in New York, which company holds the fondest memories for you?
Probably WAR in Japan. I loved working in Japan. Yeah, it was
Wrestling
fun. Wrestling Romance, yeah.
I'm having a bet which one it'd be, ECW or that one.
Yeah.
You were right.
What was the first one you said?
ECW.
Yeah, but the thing is, ECW is kind of a myth. Like, I was only there for 22 matches. Yeah, it was just like, you know, whatever that is, 11 weekends. So it wasn't like I spent years there and was one of the big, you know, flag-waving ECW guys. Mm-hmm. I loved it. It was fun. But to me, Japan was always the place that I wanted to go and to be able to make a name for myself there. And
following in the steps of Benoit.
Yeah, exactly. And to really make my mark there. And just the whole culture. I love Japan. I love the heavy metal scene there.
Listening to X from reading
X,
your book.
You know, but even like Anger and Halloween and all these bands were so popular that I'd never heard of. Well, I heard of Halloween, but I mean, just you could go there and find all these bands like Annihilator or bands that didn't have record deals in the States anymore that were still just as big in Japan. Even Mr. Big and stuff. And bands like
Mr.
So,
Big. Phenomenal musicians, aren't they?
Yeah, and all the records had, you know, bonus tracks like Blind Guardian I discovered over there. So it was cool just to be there, and I learned how to read Japanese from reading Burn magazine, which was a metal magazine over there. So it really kind of helped feed my you know, metal habit as well.
I'm intrigued about this Bob Puppets character, one of the I don't know, just
if you knew him, it'd be so funny, like, that we're actually talking about Bob Puppets in the year 2010 in Nottingham, England.
So I've got, can you describe how successful Bob Puppets was? Was he a booker or a promoter? More of a promoter, was he?
Promoter, loosely.
Yeah. And what can you remember about his character?
If you read my book, the character was, he was kind of a half-drunk guy with big glasses. If you've ever seen a movie called American Movie, there's a guy in it called Mark Borchardt. You can look him up on the internet, and he looked like Bob Puppets, kind of a big Coke bottle lenses, kind of long, scraggly hair. Brilliant. Skinny, fat guy, alcoholic body, who, because he was the promoter, just put himself as the champion in all the matches.
Right, yeah.
And when I first met him, like, I was working out in the Hart Brothers camp, and there's Bob Puppets over there. It's like, he's a big-time promoter. Like, that guy? It looks like he's, like, sweeping up the lawn at a church picnic or something. And I was like, wow, so where do you promote? You know, like, you know, Russia, Japan, Vancouver? Yeah. No, Innisfail. Innisfail? What the fuck is that? That's about 20 minutes down the road outside of Calgary, and that was about it. So the first show I ever did was for Bob Puppets in Pinoca, Alberta, Canada, at the Moose Hall, 1990. Yeah. So, yeah.
The Moose Hall, yeah.
Yeah, so I don't know what Bob Puppets is doing now, probably serving these somewhere.
Yeah. There's a lot of characters in your book I'd like to watch. Oh, can you show us? Is it Skull Norton's arm wrestling technique?
I can't do it on camera, dude.
Oh, it's
top secret.
Yeah, man. I've been asked that before, too.
Really?
I can't do it on camera. Then all the mystique is gone.
It's prestige.
Come on, man. You know better than that.
How difficult was it to adjust switching to working the right arm, the right side of the body in Mexico when you first started wrestling there?
Not even relevant.
Really?
Yeah, it was easy.
All right.
Yeah,
okay.
You might think that's a good question. I'm not trying to sandbag you, but it was really not a problem at all. I'd only been working for like 2 years at the time anyways, so it'd probably be a little bit harder now after 20 years, but 2 years, it was, I hardly knew what the hell I was doing anyway.
Oh, right, okay, yeah, so it was easy to switch.
To just switch, yeah.
Do you have any stories about the referee with ring music, Mal Mason?
Just an English referee that I met when I was in Germany. Uh-huh. And I was surprised. He was the first referee that I'd ever seen that had his own ring music, which was... I'm too sexy for my shirt.
Brilliant.
And he was, if you saw this guy, he definitely wasn't too sexy for his shirt. He was the exact opposite. And I'd just be working a match and someone would throw me off the ropes and suddenly he would just drop down in the middle and I'd have to jump over him. What the fuck just happened? And it's the realism, mate. It's like, no, the realism is you stay in the corner and stay the fuck out of my way. How's that for realism? So, he was quite the character for sure. But I actually saw him a couple of years ago
Show
at the London O2 and he wasn't very happy the way he was portrayed in my book, but I said, Mal, it's like I wasn't lying.
Yeah.
And he goes, well, I know. So then why do you have a problem? Well, you can't say that. Well, why can't I say it? You did it. It's not like I'm saying you fucking, went and screwed a chicken behind the arena. And, it's like you really did do that stuff. So
brilliant. Okay. All right. What was it like to work for Tenryu War?
Tenryu,
yeah. I'm thinking Street Fighter though, going Ryu on it.
No, he's a great boss. Like mm-hmm. I said, it was fun to work in Japan and get that experience. And
mm-hmm.
he was probably my second favorite boss that I ever worked for besides Vince.
Brilliant. And big differences between him and Anita FMW was the...
I didn't work for Anita very long, so Anita didn't really speak very good English, so it was a lot harder to understand him. But Tenryu was much friendlier, and like I said, I didn't really know Anita because I barely worked for him.
Right. Okay.
So I can't even really comment about that because I don't really know the guy very well.
Okie doke. Why was Vampiro such a dick with you?
What kind of a question is that? You read my book. Why don't you just go on camera and read? I don't know why. Ask him. I didn't fuck his mom or anything like that, so I don't know why he was a dick. Yeah. I'm not sure exactly what his problem was.
Okay. I don't know whether you'd like to do it on the camera again, but I was going to ask you to do the Nitro dance, because it says in your book to possibly...
Do it on camera, dude.
You're trying to
squeak around the edges here. If I did it on camera, then everyone would know. It wasn't really much of a dance anyways. It was like... It's funny how many people ask me about the Nitro dance,
right,
and ask me to show them the arm wrestling trick.
Uh-huh.
I've been doing a lot of signings for Chasing the Grail, and every time someone brings a book and asks me about it. And I mean, the Nitro dance has taken on a life of its own. They're expecting that I do this thriller type thing or something like that. But it really was just like me just kind of just dancing around my room going, Nitro, 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 Nitro. That's basically the extent of it.
There you go.
It's on camera there. So. But I could be lying.
Mm.
Maybe see it on stage, part of your persona. I was wondering if you're interested in MMA at all. If you ever watched UFC?
No, I've watched it a couple times. And it's pretty cool, but I have so limited time to get into anything that I just keep it to my 30 Rock and Saturday Night Live and that sort of stuff, American Idol, and I don't really watch too much more because I don't really have time, as you can imagine.
Yeah. Yeah.
With all the different stuff that I'm involved in, so I appreciate it and I respect it. And I think worked with Brock a couple times in the WWE, and I was always impressed by his agility and his speed. And why do you have Casey O'Connor's name written down there? How the hell do you even know who that is?
Just research as well. I couldn't remember who he was, so I've crossed him out.
But where did you even find the name in the first place?
I'm sure he's in the book.
He's not in the book.
Really?
No. I didn't put him in
there. Well, I must have some other deep research somewhere else, probably. Yeah.
You're all over the place.
Do you reckon any other guys that would have a shot in a UFC who could transfer over with that sort of athleticism? I know Angle's talked about dabbling in the past, but
I think Angle's too old at this point. You know, I think Angle likes to talk a lot. Plus, he has a bad neck.
Yeah.
I'm not saying he couldn't do it. I'm just saying it would. I think a lot of guys would just focus on his neck and just try and take him out from that. I don't know. I think it's hard to say, but to me, I mean, I think Haku could have beaten up anybody, you know, if he wanted to go into it, and probably even now if he wanted to. But there's a couple guys that you know have that kind of reputation over the years. But in the business now, most of the guys are soft, you know.
Right.
So,
right.
I'm not sure if anybody could really do well.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I've got during your match with Juventud Guerrero at Super Brawl 8, I really liked that. I thought it was a great match. You know, using like sort of various techniques. You know, keeping the belt on. At one point and pretending he'd tapped out. I think that's a great sort of characteristic of a heel. But I'd noticed, this is just my opinion, in WWE at the minute, heels are sort of like badass heels kind of thing. It's sort of a different generation of heel, I've noticed. So I was just wondering what your opinion on this is, and if you think the days of the cowardly heel and the cheating heel probably are drawing to a close.
I don't think they're drawing to a close, but I think there's elements you can use in that character, but you can't base your whole character around that because it really doesn't draw money. Mm-hmm. You need to be a little bit more serious than that. You can still have elements to it,
yeah.
But a total comedy heel now is basically Santino, and it's great, and it's funny, and it's he's got a great role and fits in. But as a guy who you put in there to face John Cena and have any credibility of winning, you know that he's not.
Yeah.
And I think that's the difference now, you know. And being in WCW, I wasn't getting anything anyway, so I was just trying to do anything that could get me some kind of notoriety and get something going.
Yeah.
And I still have, there's still some elements of that character in what I do nowadays, but toned down quite a bit, and you can understand the reason, like I said.
Yeah, I love the stuff with Wade Barrett when you start commentating for the commentators. I think that's really good. Yeah.
I mean, that's just more being obnoxious rather than.
Yeah, it's great.
There's a fine line, right?
Mm-hmm. So I was going to say, you're currently working with Wade Barrett. Oh, actually, before, could you talk? I've heard that you've had a brawl with Goldberg recently. I was wondering if you could talk us through how that escalated.
I'll wait till my next book.
Oh, really? how far through are you then?
Almost done, man.
Really?
I've been working on it for almost 2 years, but I've been steadily writing it for the last 4 months, and I was just working on it today, as a matter of fact. Brilliant. I got like about 25 pages left, so it's almost done.
Brilliant.
It's almost done. Well, not completely finished, but the first opening draft is almost done. Comes out in February of next year. Hopefully over here again.
Brilliant.
As well.
I was wondering, I've been looking all over the internet for some of your recordings of like Blackstone Menace and Mr. Filthy and Jesus of Gogo and that kind of stuff. I was wondering if there are
not sure. Like, Jesus of Gogo wasn't me, it was my friend, but Mr. Filthy, Blackstone Menace and Great Caesar's Ghost are all actual demos. That actually is funny because Great Caesar's Ghost, two of the songs are on Chasing the Grail, obviously well written, and the lyrics for God Pounds His Nails,
brilliant,
is on the Great Caesar's Ghost record, and that was a ballad, but the same lyrics that Rich rewrote into.
Oh, the high pitched one.
No, God Pounds His Nails is the one that's kind of like AC/DC on steroids.
Oh, right,
And Watch Me Shine was called You Can't Change the World, the same lyrics, though.
That's fantastic how you brought them songs
back
to
life. Yeah, it's funny, because I always liked the lyrics, and then this for this record, when I gave Rich all the lyrics I wanted to give him when he started writing, those were included, and he loved the two. He changed, you know, You Can't Change the World to Watch Me Shine, and then God Pounds His Nails remained the same.
I think the album's fantastic, by the way.
Thank
really,
you,
really
thank
good.
Thank you
yeah.
very much.
And, you know, I've been showing people, like, I teach music in Salford in Manchester, and I've been showing some of my colleagues, and they just, you know, I didn't, because of the association with professional wrestling, music and professional wrestling are two different entities, really, so I didn't say who it was, and they were loving every second of it, and then they was, like, really surprised that, you know, a professional wrestler's managed to come up with such good stuff.
Well, we've been dealing with that the whole 10-year existence of this band. I mean, and that's fine. I mean, I think a lot of people checked out the band because of Chris Jericho, the wrestler, and just as many people stayed away from it because of Chris Jericho, the wrestler.
Yeah.
So it takes some time to kind of build up that, I mean, like I said, 10 years and four albums. It's not just a novelty. I mean, there's something going on here, and I think some people are going, well, what do we keep hearing this Fozzy? Like, fuck, what is this thing? And then they finally check it out and go, man, this band is really good. And I think that's one thing we've been able to deal with, is that you know, there's either good music or there's bad music. And when people get over the hump that Jericho is a wrestler, which has nothing to do with this band, then realize, wow, this is good music. And then after that, it's like, well, he could be a butcher baker or a candlestick maker. We don't give a shit.
Yeah, yeah.
He's, you know, it's good, and he can sing good, and the band is great, and the fucking, I mean, we just sold out tonight. I just got the word
really?
We sold out tonight as well, and we sold out last night. So, I mean, that's one thing that's very cool, especially here in the UK. There is a momentum building. There is a buzz going on with this band, and it's a good time. It's exciting to see it growing that way, the same way that Chris Jericho in wrestling grew.
Yeah, yeah. I'm a big fan. The first two songs, the first three songs especially, the drumming on the first song, Under Black and Skies, I just think it's phenomenal. You know, the pace and
he does a great job, man.
Uh-huh.
I think we got about another minute. Didn't know that we're on at 8:40, so I got to start warming up. And stuff.
All right, no worries. Is it okay if I get a few? Is it okay if I just ask you if you can comment on a few wrestlers' names, then give you just sum it up in a sentence kind of thing? Jim Cornette, what do you think of
Crazy
Jim Cornette?
Crazy genius.
Triple H.
Well protected.
Sean Walton.
Who?
X-Pac.
Who?
Six.
Who?
Six-Pack.
That's the fucking word. Go on.
Bob Holiday.
Six-Pack, overrated.
Overrated, really?
Yeah. Bob Holiday, nice guy. That's really nice to say.
Bret Hart.
One of the best of all time.
Bischoff.
Good guy.
Stuff. Okay, yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah, is it okay if I get a few signatures, autographs?
So cool with that bad boy, please. Turn it into a thrash jacket. It's in an early stages at the moment.
Is it going to work with black?
I don't know.
Just get it on there. Get it on that badge.
Where's my bag, so?
If you had a silver one, it would look so much better. Why don't you try and find a silver? Do we have a silver sharpener here?
Where's my bag, so?
Yeah, I'll get it for you.
Get them things out.
Just stand straight for a second. I'll try this.
It's not really.
I can
get
it on there.
Brilliant.
I found it in a skip,
but
it's by the way.
In a what?
Gypsies. In a bin.
Would it be okay to sign that book for me, please? I don't know where the front is. Yeah,
cool.
What's
your name?
Stephen.
B or PH?
PH.
Sorry, please, if you won't mind. Thanks a lot.
Oh, thank you very much, Chris. I hope you had a good show.
Yeah. You guys gonna watch the show?
Yeah, we're
right, yeah. We've got guests listed because of this. All right, thanks. Is that yours, son?
Yeah, thanks, Steve. Okay. I'll pass it out, please.
Thank you very much for your time. Okay, thank you. Cheers. All right, bye.
Yeah. You got a sound recorder?
Yeah, I've got it. Uh-huh. All right, cheers. Nice one.
That's safe.
I think so.
It is
Yeah, cheers.
Thanks.
How did it go, Sam?
Good. That's a good response in there. It's a genuine
bit like me asking about Vampiro.
No, he didn't. I wouldn't know that.